There's a basic pattern to the renormalization story. You begin with some data and a model that explains the data, describes it or predicts it. Then you imagine taking that data set that you have and throwing some of it out, performing a lossy compression, for example, projecting it down, coarse graining it. So now you have a new data set related to the first, but needing a new model or new description. So then you build a model that describes or predicts or explains that simpler data set. And then you ask, what's the relationship between the model that describes the coarse-grained data and the model that describes the fine-grained data? From here to here is a coarse-graining or a projection, and what we're interested in is what this move does to this model here. How to go from here to here. And if these two models are comparable in some way, for example, if these two models share the same number of parameters, we can even talk just about how those parameters change when you go from here to here. And that's called renormalization group flow. In the case of the Markov chain, which were our first example of that whole pattern of data to data, model to model, in the case of the Markov chains, we actually got kind of lucky because when we coarse-grained that system, in particular, our coarse-graining operation was to decimate in time, only keep half of all of the time samples that we had, as if somehow we were sampling on a microphone at a lower frequency. When we tossed out half the data, the model that we used to predict or describe that new data set had exactly the same mathematical form as the original case. It was described just by a matrix, an n by n matrix, where n is the number of states that the system can be in at any point in time. And in that case, we were able to compare one matrix to another. And in fact, one of the lovely things that we saw at the end of that series was that as you coarse-grained further and further, all those matrices tended to flow towards a lower dimensional space in matrix land. The system tended to simplify to a small number of places within the space. In this section, we'll talk about a new kind of model, the cellular automaton, which has a slightly different set of properties. In many ways, it's simpler, in many ways, it's identical to the Markov chain case. In a cellular automata, what we'll see is that the state of the system at any time depends solely upon the state of the system at the just previous time step. So in other words, it's sort of forgetful, right? It doesn't matter what's happened in the deep past. All that matters is what's happening just a moment before, right? So in that sense, the system's forgetful, just like the Markov chain, and has no memory that can't be contained within a story about everything that just happened. But in another sense, we'll see that as we coarse grain in time, the number of things that this moment depends upon grows. So we'll have to be a little bit more clever about how we map models at one scale into models at another scale. So let's get specific and talk about the cellular automata themselves. Here's an example, okay, of what a cellular automata looks like. Now, how do you read this diagram, okay? Consider the very first line of pixels at the top there. You can see most of the pixels are black, then there are two white pixels. That's the state of the system at time t. There's an evolution rule, a rule about how to go from that first line of pixels to that second line of pixels, and from that second line of pixels to that third line of pixels, and so on. There's a rule that takes you from one line to the next and produces these kind of beautiful patterns that you see here. So those two little points sort of explode and evolve over time, spreading outwards and even interacting with each other like sort of waves on a beach, right? They're kind of complicated patterns. Here's the same rule, I'm going to show you now, the same update rule, but with a different set of initial conditions. And now what you can see is that in fact, whereas before we began with all black pixels except for two white ones, now what I've done is add in another two white pixels. And again, you see that same kind of triangular sort of expanding wave pattern. And now they start to interact and the system evolves differently. You see more complicated patterns the further down you go. Here's one more example of, again, the same update rule, but now with random initial conditions. So instead of sort of setting it up so almost everything was a black pixel and some were white pixels, right? Now I've just randomly laid down black and white as that first line, and you can see now as the system evolves through time, you kind of lose that very structured triangular propagating wave shape. It's almost as if you have just too many waves interacting with each other, and you get kind of these sort of big chunks of white and black triangles. All of these pictures are generated by the same rule, and that rule, in contrast to the Markov chain, is deterministic. I can tell you with certainty what will happen to one pixel depending upon all the pixels just previous. The rules themselves are incredibly simple. Here what I've done is just zoom in on an example of the first three lines of a cellular automaton. And the state of that pixel marked with a question mark depends solely above the pixel just above it, and just above it to the left, and just above it to the right. Notice that that question mark pixel doesn't depend upon, let's say, something very far to the left or very far to the right. And also, just to remind you of the kind of forgetful nature of the cellular automata, it doesn't depend on the values of pixels before the line just previous. Of course, I can use facts about the lines further up the screen to predict what that question mark is going to do, but once you tell me the value of pixel X, Y, and Z, you've determined for all time what will happen to the question mark pixel. We call that function F. That function F takes the three pixel values and tells you what will happen next. And once I define the function F, I've defined the evolution rule of the cellular automata, and all that remains is for me to lay down some initial conditions and use my computer to compute F of X, Y, and Z for all the pixels at the next line. You can think of this as a lookup table, and because the pixels can either be black or white, let's say 1 or 0, in fact, now what we have is a lookup table. I have two possible values for X, two possible values for Y, two possible values for Z, 2 to the power 3 or 8 possible values that could drive the value of the question mark pixel. And my function F has to tell you what happens for each of those possible 8 combinations. If you think about it, if there are 8 possible combinations and I have to specify a 1 or a 0 for each of those 8, I now have 2 to the power of 8 different rules, 2 choices for each value of the triplet. And so in fact, for a cellular automata defined by a neighbor rule like this one, there's only 256 possible rules that you can have. There's only 256 distinct functions F. Let's take a look at the rule I just showed you evolving. It's actually called rule 150. There's a simple way to write it. I can tell you the lookup table, but it's also possible just to phrase it in terms of logical gates. And you can phrase rule 150 as the value of the X pixel XORed with the value of the Y pixel, and that value XORed with the value of the Z pixel. XOR is 1 when one of the inputs is 0 and one of the inputs is 1, and otherwise it's 0. It's an exclusive OR. So if both are off, it's off. If both are on, it's off. And if one is on and the other is off, then it's on. Another way to talk about rule 150, another way to verbally describe that function F, is not in terms of gates, but just to say in words, the output is black when there's an odd number of black cells above. So now we can watch rule 150 evolve over time. We begin with these initial conditions, and after one step, what you can see is that the pixel just directly below that white pixel stays white, because the value just above it is white, the value above it and to the left is black, the value above it and to the right is black. That's an even number of black pixels. And so that pixel there stays white. And now you can begin to see how that starts to spread out over time and the different ways in which these triangular patterns emerge.